Can we say amen again?
Amen.
My thanks to the choir. We have this great New York Academy Choir for music you provided to enhance and enrich the worship of the Creator of heaven and earth.
Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
All the time.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I am delighted to see so many of you here this morning.
Yes,
where were you last night?
Yes.
Those of you who were here last night, did we have a good time?
Yes.
The Lord blessed us last night.
Yes.
And we inquired about those of you who were not there. We're glad you're alive. So we assume last night you were out passing out steps to Christ in your neighborhood. That's why you couldn't be here. But we're glad you're here today. This is my first visit to the Corona Seventh-day Adventist Church. So there are several things about you I do not know. For example, how do you behave during the service? I don't know. The pastor didn't tell me anything, and I'm glad he didn't, because I don't want to be prejudiced. I don't know if this is a church where parents sit and listen to the service while the children run around in the basement. I don't know if this is that kind of church. This is my first visit. So you have to help me and inform me. I don't know if this is the kind of church where while the preacher is preaching his heart out, people are sending text messages to their friends. I don't know what kind of church this is. Let me also say, I don't know what kind of academy Greater New York Academy is. So I have to trust the principal to tell me by smiling that I can count on them to be reverent in God's presence. And she hasn't smiled yet. She's smiling, somebody tell me. I can't see her very clearly. God is good, and all the time. Let me tell you what I like and what I don't like when I'm preaching. And this is all in the interest of God, not really me, because I don't count at all. I like people to be reverent in God's presence. When we're all together, then the Spirit can work. If this half is listening, that half is sleeping, and that half, usually three halves, is talking, then what is the Spirit to do? Are you following me? Remember that tremendous experience on the day of Pentecost?
Yes.
The Bible says, and when the day of Pentecost were fully come, they were all in one Spirit and in one accord. Can we have one Spirit today?
Yes.
Behind me and in front of me.
Yes.
All right. Do three things for me, then I jump into the message. It is already 25 after 12, and it's not my fault. Favor number one. If you have a cell phone, please turn it off. I know you have them, but I don't see you moving. I know you have them. If you have a cell phone, please turn it off. I made that appeal last night, and there was one rebellious vegetarian who did not turn the phone off. But I was merciful and did not strike him with leprosy. I may not be merciful today. Please turn your phones off. I didn't say down. I said off until they're dead. Favor number two, while I'm speaking, I'd like you to pray for me. What I'd like you to say is, Lord, put your words in that man's mouth. And I base that on Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 9, which says, then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. I don't want to speak my words, I want to speak God's words, because they are spirit and they are life. Favor number three, I want you to think. What does the Bible say? Isaiah 1:18, come now. Let us do what? Reason together. Think. Think. If more people would think, they would not do the things they do. They wouldn't attend the churches they attend. They wouldn't date the people they date. They wouldn't eat the things they eat. if they would just pause and do what? Our subject for today, icing with no cake. Icing with no cake. Are you ready? Let's pray. Loving Father in heaven, you know very well that I am weak. I am dirt. I am clay. I am human. Father, all of that means I need your help very desperately. Preaching is a spiritual work, and I am not naturally spiritual. And so, Father, I ask you as an expression of mercy, be with me in the person of your Spirit. Remember the words of your Son, Jesus Christ, in John 16:13, where he said, "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth." Father, let your Spirit guide me into truth, that I may guide your people into truth. Speak through me, dear God, and enlighten them. Let the Spirit touch each heart, that there may be an atmosphere of reverence in this place. As we worship the God of heaven and earth, before whom angels veil their faces. Bless not only me and us. Wherever your people are worshiping you on this day, bless them. Wherever someone is occupying the pulpit and that person's intention is to preach the truth as it is in Jesus, help that person, I pray. With thanksgiving, in Jesus' name, let all God's people say,
amen,
amen and amen. I sing with no cake. Statistics show that people without a degree, a bachelor's degree, they have an unemployment rate of about 9.1% in the United States. Those with at least a bachelor's degree, they have an unemployment rate of about 4.5 or 4.8%. What that tells us immediately is that it is economically beneficial to have some degree of education beyond a high school diploma. Statistics also show that people with a degree, at least a bachelor's degree, in their lifetime, they make hundreds of thousands of dollars more than those with just a high school diploma. Now keep in mind, statistics generalize, they don't apply to every individual. Statistics also show that the higher your level of education, the less likely you are to be involved in violent crime. And so it is a benefit to the society to have an educated population. The average person in prison does not have a degree. And so as you study and your mind is opened and you learn things, you see society differently and consequently your conduct also changes. So there are benefits to having an education. But every society has a system of education that reproduces itself. In other words, the educational system in the United States produces people who think the way virtually everybody else thinks. The educational system in North Korea produces people who think that way and who can perpetuate that system. The educational system in England produces people who perpetuate the English way of life. Every educational system produces people who perpetuate that society and its values. Because not only on the biological level, but on the sociological level, we produce after our kind. So in the United States, you grew up to believe that life is impossible without football, basketball, baseball. That's in the United States. In Europe and South America, life is impossible without soccer. In some other country, maybe Barbados, life is impossible without cricket and counties. That's the way societies function. But if each educational system just reproduces the same kind of people with the same general kind of mindset, What educational system produces people fit for the kingdom of God? Not the one in the United States. Not the one in England. Not the one in wherever. You see, Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. Consequently, the educational system that prepares us for a place in the kingdom of God cannot be of this world. Let me explain why by going back to sociology and behavior. When Jesus was arrested and he stood before Pilate, Pilate said, what hast thou done? In John 18:35, in verse 36, Jesus said to him, my kingdom is not of this world. He went on to say, if my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants do what? Fight. That I should not be delivered unto thee. But now is my kingdom not from hence. What Jesus Christ was saying, in my kingdom, in the system that distinguishes my kingdom, we do not settle disputes by fighting, by occupying Wall Street. That's not how we deal with crises, says Christ to Pilate. That's not the way my kingdom functions. That's why my servants did not fight. We don't fight in my kingdom. In my kingdom, the church boards run smoothly. Are you with me? And so the kingdom of God is so vastly different from the world in which we live that no system of the world can equip you and prepare you for a productive life in the kingdom of God. There must be another system that is on this earth, but not of this earth. You're not listening.
Yes.
You listening?
Yes.
All right. I told you at the beginning of my remarks, education has several benefits, economic, sociological, cultural. But let me ask you a question while you listen quietly and all phones are off. What's the purpose of education? Why are you in school? Don't answer me, just think. Why are you in school? Let me suggest an answer for you. One, to get a job. To get an education, to get a job. If there were no likelihood of a job after your high school and your bachelor's and your master's, would you spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on an education? But from God's perspective, what is the purpose of an education? Is it to get a job? Let's go to Genesis chapter 1. We'll read from verse 26. Our subject is, I sing with no king. Genesis 1, reading verse 26, you know it very well. The Bible says, and God said, let us make man, how? In our image, after our likeness. And verse 27 says, God created man in his own image. What does that mean? In the book, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 45, paragraph 2, Ellen White writes these words, man was to bear God's image both in outward resemblance and in character. You didn't hear what I just said. Man was to bear God's image both in what? Outward resemblance, meaning what? When Adam came from God's hand, who did Adam look like? God. Both in outward resemblance and in character. He also writes in education, I believe it's page 14. She says, when Adam came from the Creator's hand, he bore in his physical, mental, and spiritual nature the likeness of his Maker. Adam looked like God. Adam thought like God. Adam's character was like God in an infant stage, but like God. This was God's original arrangement for humanity, that we would look like him, think like him, Behave like him in every area of life, bar none. Go to Genesis 5, reading verse 3. Genesis 5, reading verse 3, the Bible says, and Adam lived 130 years and begat a son. Read the next few words for me. In his own likeness, after his image. Now, how many images do we have? Two. The image of God in Genesis 1:26. The image of Adam in Genesis 5, verse 3. Of the two images, which one did God call us to reflect? The one in Genesis 1:26. Because the image in Genesis 5:3 is the opposite of the image in Genesis 1:26. Are you following me? If it gets too difficult, let me know. I'll try to soften it up. But with all these Bright Academy students, we have to keep it at a high level. Are you with me? All right. We have an image in Genesis 1:26, the image of God, which was placed in Adam. Let me say this. If Adam had not sinned, Cain would have been born in whose image? Very good. Top marks. You get an A. A's for advertisers, by the way, when you're in school. Try to get A's. B is for, C is for, I didn't say anything, sister. Don't put words in my mouth. All I said is A is for Adventists. Get those A's in school. If Adam had not sinned, his children would have been born not in Adam's image, but in God's image. What caused the difference between the image of Genesis 1:26 and Genesis 5:3? Give me one word, three letters, begin with an S. That God sinned. Let me tell you something about God. God does not lower his standards. If he had that habit, Christ would not need to have died. God, let me say it again, does not lower his standards. Now, some of you high school scholars, I presume at Greater New York Academy, if you fail an exam, there's possibly a chance to make it up. Am I correct? No chance. Well, all right. It's tougher than I thought. All right, when I was in school, when I was also counseling, you failed an exam, you could take a makeup exam at some schools. But the results got in the makeup exam were never as high as what you should have gotten on the original. The standard was slightly dropped. God does not do that. God does not give makeup exams. Why do I say that? To say this, the standard God had for Adam and Eve before they sinned, who can read my mind and finish the statement, is the same standard he requires when? Now. Seven people said amen. There were 300 people before me. Let me say it again, whether you like it or not. The standard God had for Adam and Eve when? Before they sinned. Is the same standard he requires now after sin. What he required of them when they did not have the sinful nature is what he requires of us now while we have the sinful nature. Now that sounds unfair. How can God require of me that I live the life Adam lived before he sinned? Did I say that clumsily? Let me say it again. Before Adam sinned, God required a sinless life. After Adam sinned, God required a sinless life. How is that possible? How can that expectation hold up? There is a way. And education is at the very foundation of that way. Education, page 15, paragraph 2. Powerful quotation. To restore in man the image of his maker, to bring him back to the perfection in which he was created, to promote the development of body, mind, and spirit, that the divine purpose in his creation might be realized. This was to be the work of redemption. This is the object of education, the great object of life. By your cemetery silence, you tell me you haven't heard what I just said. We came across an image in Genesis 1:26. Give me one word to describe that image. Can you give me another word? Another word. Sinless. Blessings upon whoever said that. Give me one word to describe the image in Genesis 5:3. Sinful. Very intelligently said. Sinless, sinful. How do we get back from sinful to sinless? Education. Some of you look shell-shocked. But I'm not joking. Education. Because the science of salvation and the science of education are one. Let me say it again. The purpose of education is to restore in us the image of our Maker. Education, page 13, paragraph 1, Ellen White writes, our ideas of education take too narrow and too low a range. There is need for a broader scope, a higher aim. True education means more than the pursual of a certain course of study. It means more than a preparation for the life that now is. Now, truth be told, overwhelmingly within the church and without the church, we see education as a preparation for the life that now is. Might as well fess up. But listen to the words, the inspired words of the prophet. It means more than a preparation for the life that now is. It has to do with the whole being and with the whole period of existence possible to man. Now this is where favor number three has to come in. By the way, what's favor number three? Think. Listen to the words. It has to do with the whole period, the whole being, and the whole period of existence possible to man. Give me one word for that. I heard it from some intelligent person. Eternity. The education you get from Harvard is for now. I don't care how much you pay. It's for now. The education you get from Hofstra is for now. Now, let me say quickly, I am not saying don't go to Harvard. I am simply saying, if you go to Harvard and that's all you do, you have icing and no cake. Because the only distance that education will get you is to the fires of hell. It does not prepare you for the world to come. Notice I say, if that's all you get. You see, the way God thinks is not about the way we think. Our thoughts, my thoughts, are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says the Lord. What we consider as valuable, God considers worthless. Understand me clearly. When someone applies for a job and the employer sees Harvard, oh, come. Or the employer sees University of Michigan, my beloved school. Oh, come. Princeton, come. Is that how God views and evaluates?
No.
God looks for the education in the school of Christ. And he says, come. It has to do with the whole being and the whole period of existence possible to man. That is eternity. It is the harmonious development. Now, harmonious means there cannot be an overemphasis on one over the other. There was a time in our school system when our schools had farms. See, you don't even know that. It's been such a long time since they have them, you didn't even know that. the counsel from our prophetess. What's her name? Education should be a combination of the head and the hand. Let me tell you something. In the time of trouble, your degree will not taste delicious at all. Are you with me? I don't care what kind of paper it's printed on. You can't eat it. You can't eat this building. Sometimes I wonder if I should say the things that come to my head. But let me say it nonetheless. I'm leaving tomorrow and I should get the other one. When you want to buy groceries, those of you who live in Queens, do you go to an Adventist supermarket? Give me yes or no. Of course not. When you want your car repaired, do you go to an Adventist repair shop? When you want electrical repairs done, do you go to an electrical repair shop run by Adventists? When you want your hair done or undone, do you go to an Adventist hairdresser? When you want a suit made, do you go to an Adventist tailor? Where does all our money go? Out into the world. Are you sorry I came? No. My brothers and sisters, how many of us can use our hands? Most people don't need a sociologist. They don't like me, it's okay. I'm going back to Indonesia, they love me over there. Most people do not need a sociologist. They need an electrician. They need a plumber. They need a carpenter. Are you with me? Most people do not need a psychiatrist. They just need to stop sitting. But you always need a tailor. You always need a dressmaker. You always need a cobbler. You know what a cobbler is? All right. Your day is blessings on you, sister. But where do we go? We go to the areas that the world describes as prestigious. Then we work for other people. And they decide whether we get Sabbath off or not. But as we come to these last days, we need to control our time. Working for yourself. Let me go on with the quotation and ease your discomfort. It has to do with the whole being and the whole period of existence possible to man. It is the harmonious development of the physical, the mental, and the spiritual powers. Now, is the Bible the number one textbook at Harvard? No. At Oakwood? No. Is this being recorded? Don't send it Oakwood. Is the Bible the number one textbook in our average school? Possibly not. The harmonious development of the physical, the mental, the spiritual powers, it prepares the student for the joy of service in this world. Listen to the wording. And the higher joy of wider service in the world to come. Let's compare two statements. It prepares the students for the joy of service in this world. There's joy and service. And for the higher joy of wider service in the world to come, then where should your emphasis be as you pursue an education? This life or the life to come? The life to come. Now, I didn't say you should not emphasize this world. I'm simply saying, where should your greater emphasis be? I was attending a camp meeting several years ago somewhere in New York State, and I was counseling between preaching assignments, and this young lady came to me crying. She said, "Why are you crying?" My parents refused to send me to that Adventist school I wanted to go, but they said Adventist education is inferior. And I needed to go to the best schools in the world, and I'd be getting to a medical school of some reputation. And she said, no sooner did I enter that secular school than every belief I had was severely tested. She said, now I have one foot in the world, one foot in the church. Why, she didn't say it, but I knew she meant the foot in the church was on a banana peel. That same camp meeting, a young man came to me. What's the problem? My father. What's wrong with your father? When I pick up the Bible to read it, he kicks it out of my hand. So I said, well, your father's not a Seventh-day Adventist. I can understand why he would do that. And I said that deliberately. He said, no. My father grew up in the church. He literally said, kick. So I asked him, why would your father, a baptized Seventh-day Adventist, vegetarian, love soy milk, kick the Bible out of your hand? You know what he told me? He said, the Bible won't get you a job. Your physics books will pick it up. Now, this is a Christian, in quotation marks, who functions by the standards of this world, not the world that Christ has prepared for you and for me. You see, the world says an education is the foundation of a blessed, secure life. God says Christ. That amen was lifeless. Come on, strengthen it. I know you're smiling, but you don't like what I'm saying. Some of you are saying, well, should I drop out of school? No, I'm not saying that. I'm simply saying you need to understand what you're doing and why. And so the father kicked the Bible out of his hands. Pick up your physics book. As I told some my friends who came last night, if your child said to you, mother, I want to be a cup holder, what would you say to the child after you recover from your faint? What would you say? Would you be proud? No. You'd probably say, the neighbor's children are in medical school. Your cousins, your uncle's children are in dental school. The lady I work with, her child is in law school. You want to be a comporter? That embarrass me. That's how we think. Because a comporter's work is not, in the eyes of the world, prestigious. You see, the builders of Babel, if you follow Genesis 11, verse 1 and onward, the Bible said, and the whole earth was of one language and one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, verse 4, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name. Let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. Now, they wanted to make a name for themselves. And in this world, education is a way of making a name for you. But listen to what God told Abraham, and we are the descendants of Abraham. The very next chapter, Genesis 12, reading from verse 1. Now, the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great. It is God's business to make your name great. It is your business to make his name great, not yours. Anytime you and I embark on a mission to make our name great, we come into conflict with God. And the educational system of this world is designed to make your name great. God says, that's my work. Your work is to make my name great by reflecting my image. An education that prepares you for this world alone is icing with no cake. And sad to say, That's the education most Adventist young people are pursuing. I don't want to embarrass anyone, but and I won't. If I were to ask one of my young brothers and sisters something about biology, they'd probably answer me correctly. If I were to ask what a three angels message is, they probably wouldn't. If I were to ask not just my brothers and sisters from the academy, anyone listening to me, give me the lyrics from a Lady Gaga hymn. I sing them like hymns. You would give them to me. Recite Revelation 6 through 12. Couldn't do it. Revelation 14, 6 through 12. Name five singers in a bronze society. You give me bam, 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 bam. Starting with Rihanna from Barbados. Name five pioneers of this church. Couldn't do it. But where are we all headed? The land of the pure and the holy. May I ask you a question? Now, in a certain sense, God is old. We know that. Been there a long time. But he's not senile. Are you with me? You can't pull the wool over God's eyes. He has too many of them. My brothers and sisters, young, old, and in between, listen to Jesus Christ. Matthew 16:24. What shall it profit a man or a woman if that person gains what? The whole world. Finish the verse. That's the path many of us are on. And the close of probation is too late to change that path. But look at the words of Christ closely. He did not say, don't gain the world. He said, don't gain it at the expense of your soul. But if you can gain the world and preserve your soul, go get the world. How many people you know have ever done that? What is the purpose of education? Let me answer the question this way. It is now 5 to 1. When did I start? 25 after? I have 15 minutes, I believe. I'll try not to make them prophetic. See how slow they are? Should have been laughing immediately. Understood what prophetic time is. Pastor, I'm so glad you have a prophecy seminar. That it's 4 o'clock today, am I right? I'd like the church to look like this. Where do you go after the midday service? Where do you go? And do what? With whom? I can never understand this in Adventist churches. You've got a million people for the midday service. You've got 6 for your wife. And they all claim we don't work on Sabbath. Why don't you all come back and learn something? Save your soul and somebody else. How many will come back this afternoon? All right, this is a manicured hand. It's okay, okay. And I'm getting to like you. I'm not sure you like me yet. What's the purpose of an education? Listen to Psalm 19, verse 1. You know where Psalm is? Can you find it? Try. Go ahead, find Psalm. You have it? Who has Psalm 19:1? God bless you, sister. All right, my handsome brother to the left with a tie like mine, he has Psalm 19:1. Let's read it. The heavens declare what? The glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Stop. The heavens declare. What are the heavens? The sky. All right. Listen to Isaiah 6 verse 3. the whole earth is full of his glory. What did Psalm 19:1 say? The heavens declare the glory of God. Isaiah 6:3, the whole earth is full of his glory now. So the glory of God is where? Heaven and earth. Heaven and earth means everywhere. Question for you. What is the glory of God? Which is everywhere. Here's what you think the glory of God is. A bright light. And sometimes glory is used to refer to the light, the brightness of God. But fundamentally, essentially, primarily, chiefly, and principally, the glory of God is his character. God's Amazing Grace, page 322, paragraph 2, Ellen White writes, the glory of God is his character. But let's prove that from the Bible. Go to Exodus chapter 33, reading from verse 18. Our subject is, I sing, finish it, and no king. Has anyone said, Lord, put your words in that man's mouth? God bless you, your families, your health, and your wealth. The rest of you who have not prayed, pray. And say, God, put your words in that man's mouth. Never allow a preacher to preach to you without praying for him or her. You see, I'm not perfect. Only Christ can preach a perfect sermon. I am made of dirt. And so a little dirt may come out on the message. To protect your mind from my dirt, you pray. So if God answers your prayer and puts his words in my mouth, you benefit. What is the glory of God? I said to Exodus 33, reading from verse 8, the Bible says, and he said, show me thy glory. Who is he speaking those words? Speaking to whom? God. Verse 19, and he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim my name before thee, and will have mercy, be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. Now God told Moses, you cannot see my face, which is what Moses wanted to see, but I will show you my goodness. I will make all my goodness. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. Chapter 34, verse 5 of Exodus. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed the Lord merciful and gracious, long-suffering, abundant in truth and goodness, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty. Now God is giving Moses a glimpse of who he is, his character. Moses says, show me thy glory. God says, here is my glory, because my glory is my character. And so Jesus prayed in John 17:22, and the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. Not light, but the character of God, which Christ gave to the disciples through his teachings. Glory is character. The heavens declare the glory of God. The earth is full of the glory of God. Now, heaven and earth, the character of God. When you study biology, you have an excellent opportunity to gain insights into the glory of God. When you study history, you have a glorious opportunity to see the hand of God. Because history is merely what? Prophecy fulfilled. If you study accounting, you have an opportunity to see the glory of God as you realize that the tithing system is the original accounting system. You study zoology. Let's go down the alphabet. Accounting to zoology. God made the animals. No one helps you. And now you begin to understand why the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. To really begin a journey for knowledge, you begin with acknowledging God. That is the education that prepares you for the world to come. Now, having acquired this education, this knowledge, How you apply it, that's wisdom. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So getting the knowledge should begin with God. Using the knowledge should begin with God. This is the education that prepares you for the presence of God. Is that the education you're getting? Don't answer. Let me tell you something you already know. When something that's wrong persists for a long time, it begins to look right.
Yeah.
Ah, you didn't hear me. Let me say it again. When something that is wrong has a long shelf life, it begins to look right and normal. I can give several examples, but I don't want to embarrass anyone. The examples have to go with how we dress, how we wear our hair, what we do with our nails, what we do with our ears, what we do with whatever, how we eat, how we socialize. What used to be absolutely unacceptable is now acceptable. Look, remember there was a word called underwear? You remember those days? When there was something genuinely called underwear. Do you know underwear is now overwear? You don't believe me? No, I'm always on planes flying. So I'm always all over the world, and I see people. And I say, does she know that her underwear is now overweight or outerwear? I was in a conference office a few years ago. Seventh Adventist conference hall. You know, I look pretty in my suit, trying to look sinless. And I'm in this conference office. And this worker in the office passes by. A short little shirt, jeans, low riders, with a high riding thong. I'm serious. So I said, no, I didn't just see that. Something that will change. God is good. All the time. Let me double check. A rebuke, but I need evidence. So I turn around as cool as I can, and I say, yes, I saw it right the first time. I said, can I talk to you? He goes, okay. He was facing me, so I didn't see anything this time. I said, do you realize how exposed you are? She said, yes, Elder, I have a jacket in my office. I said, sister, the jacket is not the problem. Even without a jacket, you shouldn't walk around like this in an office where men go in and out. Men trying to do right. You cannot do that. Where's your husband? I need to talk to him. And she said, I'm sorry. I said, no, you're not sorry. There's some things people do deliberately. You don't accidentally dress like that. Are you with me? It's normal. Man, it's normal. There was a time when you saw a guy's pants down here, you thought, well, he's going behind a tree to, he can't find a toilet anywhere. He's headed for a bush. But not anymore. That's the way it is. Still talking about education, because this thing applies to our education as well. Are you with me? So we have some schools with competitive schools. They're playing non-academic schools competition, and fights break out. We call that witness. My brothers and sisters, We are called to be different. I was in Guyana. Any Guyana? Nice to see you. Just woke up. All right, I was in Guyana. And I was across a river. I was walking somewhere, and I looked across the other side of the river, and I saw two young men. You know what I said? Two Mormons. I knew they were Mormons. No guesswork. Dark pants, white shirt, dark tie, badge, and a decent-looking bag. And they're walking together. Two Mormons. Mormons. Any Sunday, you see two people dressed up going from door to door, you will not assume they're Adventists. Who are they? The whole world knows that. How do you spot an Adventist? You see my problem? You see why I have no hair? I worry for the church, I really do. I worry for the church. As I go around and I observe the total theological ignorance in the church, I sometimes want to cry. Literally cry. Adventists know nothing about what Adventists believe. And if they knew, their lives would change. Because the message God has given to us is so powerful. When I think of our young people, you know, we're quick to condemn our young people. But a young person is what he or she is because of parents. I don't care what you say to me. Young people don't raise themselves. Young people are what they are because of parents. So I don't condemn the young people. They're trying to find a way because no one showed them anything. So they're looking for a way. When you're looking for a way, Satan says, not her. She's looking for a way. She has no way. Let me give her a way. Her parents haven't given her a way. I'll give her one. When she has a problem, she can take it back home. Not to me, says Satan. Take it back home. My brothers and sisters, what appears normal to us may be abnormal to God. And on this education day, as we talk about icing with no cake, is the education you're getting pure icing? Is it preparing you for a place in God's kingdom? Are you growing in your appreciation of Jesus Christ? Are you growing in your Christ-likeness? Are you developing a thirst for the Lord to come and an impatience with this world with all its crime and corruption and filth? Or is your education causing you to question, doubt every Adventist doctrine? The purpose of education is to bring us back to the ideal God had when he made Adam and Eve and said, let us make man in our image. That's the purpose of education. The number one purpose of education in the eyes of God is not to get a job. I said it's not the number one. There's nothing wrong with jobs, don't get me wrong. The commandment that says rest one day tells us work six. God can't command you to work if there are no jobs. What I'm saying is the fundamental purpose of education is the restoration of the image of God in us. And the foundation of that education is God Christ. And so the heavens declare the glory of God. The earth is full of the glory of God, which means the entire universe. Any branch of knowledge you study is an opportunity to meet with God. Education, page 14, paragraph 2, Ellen White writes, any line of study of investigation we pursue with a sincere purpose to arrive at truth. A sincere purpose to arrive at truth we are brought into contact with the unseen, mighty intelligence that is working in and through all. The mind of man is brought into communion with the mind of God, the finite with the infinite. What she's saying is that an education that is a pursuit of truth brings your mind into contact with the mind of God. And she concludes by saying, the effect of such communion on body and mind and soul is beyond estimate. Then after what? A sincere purpose to arrive at truth. That's the purpose of education. Restore in us the image of God. Let me say quickly, I don't want to delay you, and Julie has been very kind giving me time. There are some Adventist students who believe the Sabbath is getting in the way of my education. All my friends have Sabbath to study, and I happen to be in church singing dull, boring hymns. I need the Sabbath to study. Here's a mistake you make. Regardless of the level of your education, high school, kindergarten, university, to take time away from God to give to academic study is to hurt yourself. Listen to the words of the prophet, Mind, Character, and Personality, Volume 1, page 34, paragraph 2, Ellen White writes, in as in the case of Daniel, in exact proportion. Now you statisticians, what is meant by exact proportion? Same amount. In exact proportion as the spiritual character is developed, the intellectual capabilities are increased. What is she saying in simple Corona English? As you grow spiritually, your mind grows mentally. So that when you take away from God's word, then the mind necessarily shrinks, even though you may pass. But you suffer spiritual damage. Let me give you the reference again. Mind, Character, and Personality, Volume 1, page 34, paragraph 2, in exact proportion. And these are deliberately chosen words. As the spiritual character is developed, the intellectual capabilities are increased. Councils for the Church, page 207, paragraph 6. As an instrument or a means of intellectual training, the Bible is more important than any book or than all other books combined. Dead amen. You're giving me. Somebody say amen. Amen. As a means of intellectual training, the Bible is more important than any other book or all other books combined. Which means your attention. The Bible. People wonder, how did Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, you know who they were? Who were they? Shadrach, Meshach. I don't know why we call them Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Those are Babylonian names, pagan names. Their names were Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah. That's what I like. You know why they were so faithful to God? The training they received as little children. And that training was based on what scriptures they had back then. The training based on the word of God. We marvel at Daniel going to a lion's den. His faith in God was based on his early training. We marvel at Moses. His faith was based on his early training in the word of God. Let me tell you something. As your ability in God's word increases, it becomes easier for you to learn the academic material. Christ Object Lessons, page 125, paragraph 3. Listen to this. If the follower of Christ will believe his word and practice it, there is no science in the natural world he will not be able to grasp and appreciate. Are you flunking physics or obeying God? Christ Object Lessons, page 125, paragraph 3. If the follower of Christ, if I ask for a show of hands, who's a follower of Christ, every hand would go up, would believe his word and do what? Practice it. There is no science in the natural world which is the whole universe. And you will not be able to grasp. Not just hold with two fingers, I mean understand, grasp, and appreciate. You damage yourself by thinking the Bible is holding you back. The only thing the Bible holds you back from is hell. My brothers and sisters, my young brothers and sisters at Greater New York Academy, my older brothers and sisters at World Academy of Book, or college, or community college, or university, or postgraduate institute of higher learning, which is really not higher. Make the Word of God the foundation of your education. Because it is not a degree that gets you to heaven, it is the character of Christ in us. Are you with me? And the only text that produces that is this. Not sitting on the shelf, but as a living power in the heart. An education without Christ is icing with no cake. I appeal to you as someone who is counseled at the academic level, university level, college level. I have gone to community colleges, spoken to high school students. I know what I'm talking about. If you put God first, you will not suffer. Now you can put God last and still pass. There are a lot of atheists with PhDs, so they pass. But the ultimate test is coming. Are you with me? The ultimate test is coming, and that's where your emphasis should be. Am I ready to enter the kingdom of God when Jesus comes back? And the standard is not based on your ACT, or your RIP. That standard is based. This should be a Corona slow church. That standard is based on God's Ten Commandments. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter as I close with the Holy Word. Fear God and do what? Keep His commandments, for this is what? The whole duty of man is to live in harmony with the law of God, and the entire Bible is an extended explanation of God's Ten Commandments, which themselves can be condensed into one word, love, which itself can be expressed in one word, the character of God, which can be expressed in one word, the glory of God. For those of you who weren't here last night, you should ask your friends what was said. Because I think you'll benefit if you get the tape or whatever it's made, DVD, CD. But for today, I'd like to ask you a question, make an appeal to you. You have youth on your side, you're young. Your brain is strong. You have time. For those of us 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, time is gone. But you still 13, 14, 15, you have time. If you realize you're on the wrong road, you've got time to change. That's a blessed thing to be 12, 13, 14. Another reason why sin has not yet got you to do a lot of wickedness. See, when you're 50 and 60, the devil has got you to do 60 years of wickedness. When you're 14, you've only done 14 years of wickedness, God can fix that like that. But when you're 60 and 70, you are a professional sinner. He's just an amateur. So God can fix you fast. But for me and you, God has to perspire to change us. So you're at the ideal stage to say, Lord, before I take one step further in the wrong direction, let me switch directions. You know, when Moses saw the burning bush, he said, I will now and see this great sight. As I have presented education and its primary function, which is the character of God in you and me, as you see this great sight, if you know you're on the wrong path, wrong thinking, wrong ambitions, this is a good time, by the grace of God, to turn aside. And so to my young brothers, academy or not, speaking to the youth first, anyone 19 and under. If you'll say, Father, this message has opened my eyes. Help me, Father, to put you first, to make your word the foundation of my education. If my school doesn't do it, help me as an individual to do it. Help me to make your word, preparation for your kingdom, my priority. How many of my young brothers and sisters will make that commitment? Let me add, God bless you, sister. I want you to stand up. I want you to stand up where you are. I want you to stand. You make that commitment, I want you to stand. I want to make the character of Christ in me my priority. Because it is when Christ is in me that my perspective on life becomes clear and correct and untainted. I'm speaking to those 19 and under. 19 and under, yes. For the rest of us, I make the same appeal. Whatever your area in life, your professional expression, if this message has shown you that a preparation for God's kingdom is not your emphasis, and you want to say, Father, help me to make changes in my life by your power to make sure that when Christ comes, I'll be ready for a place in his kingdom. If you will make that decision, can I see your right hand? God bless you. Stand up with me. And my young brothers and sisters. We want a cake that has icing on it. We don't want icing with no cake. And that is what the educational system of the world prepares you for. Icing, no cake. This life will last this long. Eternity has no end. Intelligent thinking tells me, prepare for eternity. Intelligent thinking tells me, engage in risk management. And I have to manage the risk of being lost. And the best way to manage that risk is to get on the side of Jesus Christ. Have another appeal to make. It may sound strange given the message, but I'll make it. There's some of you listening to me. You need to be baptized. You've not yet made that decision. But you need to make it. I'm not saying you need to be baptized today or tomorrow. You need to tell God, Father, I am willing to be baptized when the time is right. Is there someone like that who needs to make that decision? I am willing to be baptized. I want to see your hand. Just raise it. I'm not yet baptized. I need to make that decision. I want you to raise your right hand. And you and the leaders of the church can decide the time with your parents. Anyone? I need to be baptized. Union with Christ, as we read at the beginning of the service. Knowing not that so many of us have been baptized into Christ, we're baptized into his death. Galatians 3:26, you're baptized into Christ, you have put on Christ. Anyone? Just raise that right hand. Why pray? Any hand raised behind you? Heads bowed, eyes closed. Righteous Father in heaven, we come to the end of this part of your day, the divine hour, Education Day at Corona SDA Church. We thank you, Father, for your word, its clarity, its power, its conviction on our hearts. Dear God in heaven, help us to ask ourselves the question, what am I doing? Where am I going? And where's Christ in all of this? Father in heaven, your word says, remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth. The best time to be serious with you is when we are young. Father, in this church are many young people who've made commitments to make you first. Give them the help they need, their God. I believe in the heart of every one of them is a genuine desire to do what is right. But they look around at us who set bad examples and they get confused. So forgive the older ones who misinformed them by our twisted lives and our hypocritical examples, saying one thing, living another kind of life. And so, Father, we do not blame the youth. We ask you to help them. Forgive us for being bad models. Help us to live right, that we may guide them aright. But grant them your spirit. At the age of 12, Jesus Christ knew who he was and what his mission was. At the age of 8, Josiah was a king of Judah, and he turned not to the right nor to the left. He did what was right in the sight of God. 13, 14, 15 are ages at which someone can be serious, not frivolous. Please, God, touch everyone who heard the message. Whether we're in school or at work, the message applies. What is the foundation of our efforts? Is it the character of Christ? Is it the preparation for the life that's coming? Please, God, bless all our schools around the world. Let them return to the ideal that the purpose of education is to reproduce the image of God in sinful man. Bless not only the students, bless the teachers, bless the parents who sacrifice so much, eh, God. Help us all to remember we're all in the school of Christ. So God, as we leave or we separate, let not this message evaporate from our minds. Let us think of what we've heard. And what we've heard is education and salvation in the eyes of God are one. What we've heard is that the purpose of education is to restore in us, regardless of age, the image of God. So bless us, help us, and Father, when you come into your kingdom with your Son, save us without losing one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.